on this beautiful summer-like weekend. We're going to get started right away, so we're going to invite you to stand and join along, sing along at home, and we hope that you enjoy the service.
Through the blind of sin, through the milk of sin, through the dead will rise, through our hearts will praise, through the darkness fades, because of you my heart springs, I am free. I am free.
thank you so much for joining us for worship this morning. Whether this is your first Sunday with us or you've been a lifelong member of Crossroads Church since we started not too long ago, we are glad to have you with us today. Thank you for joining us. For those who are joining us online, we want to invite you to take a moment, if you have not done so already, to go ahead. Let us know that you are here. You can wave, that's fine. But we also have a record of attendance. If you want to scan that QR code or click the link if you are tuning in online, and let us know you are here today. There's a spot to share your response to the service today. Maybe you're touched by a song. Maybe you're moved by the Holy Spirit. Maybe today is the day where you're beginning again and giving your life to Christ. There's an opportunity to let us know that on that. And there's also a chance to share any prayer requests that you might have. Maybe you or somebody you know that's going through a struggle and you would like our prayer team to be praying for you. We have a fantastic prayer team, don't we, Cheryl? She won't say so because she's part of it, but yes, we do. No, she did say that. So we would love to be praying for you. We have a couple of events coming up this summer. I apologize, I did not get them in the slides there, Tom. But coming up June 17th. Is that right, Melissa? That's Melissa. 16th, Thursday the 16th. Woo, good thing I checked. Thursday the 16th, we have a youth event that's going to be taking place at the Dual Household. We're going to be doing some water games. Hopefully it's warm like it's been this weekend, and an outdoor movie night. And so if you have somebody who's going into fifth grade or older, we're going to start kind of mixing in some of those youth group activities, some fun events. We got a wonderful movie picked out, and so we want to invite you to come and join us, hang out, have a great time. 16th. I'm already blanking on it. See, I got this baseball schedule in my head. I can tell you that Wednesday, the 14th, is a baseball game, but I can't tell you that Thursday, not the 17th, is 16th or 15th. Yeah, see? Get me in the right zone. All right, so enough of that. Also, coming up, we have Red Rock Camp. We're really excited about that. I believe I know the date of that. It's June 19th. We're going to be taking off. Is that right? That's okay. Thank you. And, of course, if you'd like to help support the children and youth and those that are going to be heading to camp, you can do so online at elkomarketchurch.com/give. You can designate a portion of your offering if you'd like to support that. Our missions offering this month is going to go to help offset the cost of camp for our children and youth and those that are attending. And so thank you so much for your generosity. I don't know if you realize how expensive camps got. It's got from $50 when I was a kid to like $500 some of these camps cost. Red Rock's not quite that expensive, but definitely come and join us for part of the week, for a night, if you'd like. It'll be a fantastic time. All right, enough of struggling to remember dates and times and things like that with announcements. If you have your Bibles with you today, I'm going to invite you to open up to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. You can throw a bookmark in there, hang on to that, pull it up on your phone if you like, and you can follow along in our message today. On February 8th, I know that date's correct because I wrote it down and I looked at it. On February 8th, a few students decided to linger just a little bit longer after the chapel service had ended. It was this wonderful moment of prayer and worship, and so they continued to gather together to pray and sing. But after class, some students were surprised to see that there were still people in the chapel praying and singing. And more students came, and over the course of the next 2 weeks, it is estimated that nearly 50,000 students and visitors came to Asbury to take part in the revival. This Asbury revival was not something that was unique in the school's history. As a school in the Wesleyan tradition, theological tradition, there was this emphasis on transformational encounters with the Holy Spirit. And so this wasn't something that was new to the seminary, new to the group that was there. But a revival like this doesn't just happen because of great planning, right? We can't just say, all right, we're going to have a revival today. Oh, I guess I failed on my plan, right? And it doesn't happen because we have professional musicians or because we have the best lineup of speakers. The revival occurs as a movement of the Holy Spirit when we have hearts and minds that are hungry to encounter God in this way. And while the statistics might tell us that more Bible tells us that, right? Ecclesiastes, I think it's chapter 3, but my memory's not so great today, says that God puts all of these wonderful things that are beautiful in their season. God does it so that we will revere Him. That there's a part of us, this desire to know God, hardwired into us. And so whether we ever step foot into a church or not, there is that curiosity to know our Maker, right? To know how this world came to be. And a heart that is set on fire changes us. A heart that is set on fire by the Holy Spirit with this intense hunger and longing for God will change us. And so it shouldn't surprise us that God could turn a seemingly ordinary chapel service into a transformational moment. It's a part of our heritage. I know we don't really talk about denominations much anymore, but we share the same religious heritage as Asbury University and Asbury Seminary. In fact, in my line of succession of elders orders, just to show that I am credentialed in something here, I brought my certificate here today. I actually have names that you might recognize if you are Wesleyan or familiar with Wesleyan traditions, like John Wesley and Thomas Coke and Francis Asbury. So right there in that line of succession. So we are people that come from this revivalist tradition. We come from this tradition that was focused on personal holiness and social holiness. And so it should come as no surprise. We come from a Wesleyan tradition, but what exactly does that mean for us today? Like, what does that mean for us here in Elko, New Market? And how have the foundations that were set before us helped us become who we are today? Well, foundations matter. The foundation is what determines what you can build, right? It's not real complicated. I know we've got some people in the trades and some builders as a part of our church. They probably can tell you better than I can how important that foundation is and how it can determine how many levels up you can go and what kind of materials you build with. And if the foundation is poor, you want to try to build something grand because you realize it's not going to support it. If the foundation is spectacular, you probably wouldn't build a tiny little shack on it. The Apostle Paul writes to the church in Corinth in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, asking them to consider the foundation that they are building upon. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 10 and following says this: according to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I lay the foundation. And someone else is building on it. Each builder must choose carefully how to build on it. For no one can lay any foundation other than the one that has been laid. That foundation is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on the foundation with gold or silver or precious stones or wood or hay and straw, the work of each builder will become visible. For the day will disclose it, because it will be revealed with fire. And the fire will test what sort of work each has done. If what has been built on the foundation survives, then the builder will receive a reward. If the work is burned, the builder will suffer loss. The builder will be saved, but only as through fire. Paul writes to the church of Corinth, saying, according to the grace that God has given me, like a skilled master builder, or like an architect, as some translations say, I laid the foundation. That is Jesus Christ. Paul had been called to take the gospel message of Jesus to a group of people that had not yet received it. They had not heard the word. For up to this point, they had been left out. And so he brings the gospel to the Gentiles. And he recognizes that this calling is a gift from God, an honor that he has to bring that foundation of Jesus to a people that did not yet know him. Jesus is the foundation. Jesus is the foundation of the church. And all of us Christians, no matter our background or where we've come from, all Christians, that is, all Christ-believing followers, hold this foundation in common. Our confession of faith in Jesus Christ as the Son of God, the one who had came to save us from our sin. But that confession is just a step on our journey. While Paul may have been the chief architect, he was dependent upon others to come and to complete the work, right? He didn't get to stay in Corinth. In fact, he'd go and he'd start get them organized and share the gospel message, and then you leave it up to the laity to go ahead and continue the work of building up the mission. He warns the builders, though, to consider carefully how it is that they are going to build. If the foundation determines the building, then it would have been scandalous to build a shack on a foundation that was meant for a grand temple. The question we must ask ourselves is, are we constructing a life worthy of the foundation that we build upon? I left these verses out, but if you read ahead in 1 Corinthians, this is where that whole, like, your body is a temple piece. And so it just kind of continues that metaphor. How are we building our lives on that foundation of Jesus Christ? And so it challenges us to think about, are we constructing a life worthy of the gift that we've been given, worthy of the foundation of Jesus Christ? Paul uses the same kind of metaphor that Jesus used when he ended the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 7. You might recall that Jesus compared two different kinds of life, one that was built on the knowledge and on the words and the application of Jesus' teachings, and the other that was built without regard of Christ. There was a house that was built on the rock and a house that was built on the sand. And if you remember the Bible story, you realize that the house on the rock stood firm when the storms came, and the one on the sand had washed away, crumbled, for the foundation wasn't there. We must carefully build a life worthy of the foundation that has been laid for us. Paul knows that a time will come when our work will be examined. The day of judgment when Christ returns. On that day, our work with our life, what we've done with Jesus, will be tested. Now, Christ doesn't come to test our salvation, but that's already been assured through our faith in Jesus Christ. But Christ will examine the value of our life's work. Have we given our life to things of meaning? What did we do with the gospel that has been revealed to us? You see, Paul says the builder isn't saved by the work that he builds. No, we are saved by the grace of God. But what we do with that gift does matter in the kingdom of God. How will we use that grace that has been given to us to build up God's kingdom? Our lives, our communities, and our world. I was about 9 or 10 years old when I first remember praying that prayer. You know, when somebody's telling you, like, if you want that assurance of eternal life, all you have to do is pray this prayer and invite Jesus into your life. And I thought, wow, that's like, I don't want to miss out. Like, the other alternative doesn't sound very good. And so I remember inviting Jesus into my life, going like, okay, how's this going to happen? Jesus is going to come inside of my heart. That seems strange, but okay, I'm going to do this. And even though I didn't quite understand it, God was doing something in that moment. And shortly after that, I started getting this strong hunger, this desire to know God. I was reading my Bible and trying to pay attention to the pastor at church and serving my community the best I could. When one day, there was a pair of missionaries. I didn't bring the tapestry that they had made that was hanging up in my hometown church that I now have. But I believe it was the gardeners. Might have been Gordon Gardner, if I remember the name on the back of that correctly. But anyway, they came and they talked about the work that they were doing on the other side of the world, it seemed like to me. And I went home that day and I said, that's what I need to do with my life. I want to serve God full time. I wasn't exactly sure what it would be. I thought maybe at one point in time, I thought maybe I'll be a missionary in the remote jungle, because I like hanging out in the woods. And then I was exposed to camping ministry. I thought, this is the best job ever. I want to be a camp director where I can run my own church camp and I can spend my summers fishing and playing in the woods. You see the name, okay? And then I realized, no, camp directors, they don't get to enjoy their time off ever. They're always doing something. And I thought, no, I think God is calling me to be a pastor. And over the years, through that discernment process, God made it clear that I was going to be a pastor, but I wondered, how do all these pieces fit together? And then one day we were in class, a class that was about reaching new people and evangelism and mission, and this professor shared about church planting. Kind of sounds strange, like you just like put a cross in the ground, water it, and up pops a church, right? Some of you should go try that and let me know if a church pops up. I mean, it'd be kind of cool. And I'm like, oh, this sounds interesting. building on the foundation where nobody else had built. And that's what stirred in my heart. But God, like, up to this point, I thought I'm just going to serve some small church, some small town outstate Minnesota, because that's all I had ever known. The cities were too big for me. I don't even drive in the cities. I made Melissa do all the driving when we first started dating because I was scared out of my mind. I'm still scared out of my mind some days. And in 2002, pulled off the interstate on the shortcut, and I came through this town. God said, "Here, this is where you belong." I thought, okay, God, I don't see a whole lot. There's a lot of houses coming up. There's one church. There's some bars. I started leaning into that, praying and fasting and coming and talking to folks in town and hearing their stories and their struggles and hearing them describe the spiritual makeup of this community. God said, "You belong here." I totally lost my spot in my sermon here. But I realized that God was calling me to pull out all those pieces together to build a foundation, to build something here to serve this community. John Wesley was also called to be a missionary. For those in the room today, I brought a special statue that was given to me. I think it's one of eight that were ever made. And I might be the only one that's not a bishop that owns one right now. So it was a very special gift from our dear friend Ruth Wurtzema. And John Wesley was a missionary. Early in his ministry experiences, though, he didn't really find success. In fact, John Wesley's trip to the Americas, to America, to evangelize the Indians and minister to the colonies, ended up in a complete failure. If you're familiar with the story, you might know that John Wesley came to, like, Georgia. And while he was trying to do all these things, he kind of, a girl caught his eye. And when she married somebody else, he, for some reason, one reason or another, he doesn't exactly say why, he denied her communion. But she had some prominent connections. And so because of her prominent connections, John Wesley was brought up on charges, and a lawsuit was pending, and then there was like a warrant for his arrest. And basically, I sometimes say, like, he almost literally got tarred and feathered. And so he's like seeing no option for the work to continue here. He sneaks out, he leaves, he goes through some swamps, he gets lost in the woods, eventually he makes it onto the ship, and he heads back to England, a total failure. That's how we started here in the United States. But John Wesley's story actually begins earlier than his failed missionary endeavor. John was born in 1703 as the 15th out of 19 children. 15 out of 19 children. I think if I remember correctly, only about 10 of them made it to adulthood. His father was an Anglican priest, Samuel and Susanna Wesley. And at this time, the church had very close ties to the throne. In fact, John Wesley's father was known as a royalist priest. It means he was in favor of this close connection. And I understand that maybe John's mother had some differing political views. And so John had been the experience of both of this. When John was about 6 years old, there was this terrible fire that caught in their home, and everyone escaped except for John, who was stuck inside. Thankfully, John was rescued, and his mother was quoted as saying that John was a brand plucked from the fire. For she felt that John had been saved by God for a very special purpose. And so this stuck with him. Sometimes a six-year-old boy might pick up on things that their parents say. He thought, this, I have to live a life that is worth saving. So that kind of stuck with him in his mind. He was very disciplined in his faith, and at the suggestion of his father, he went into the ministry, studying to become a pastor. But John's life, while he struggled in his faith, on the trip back to England, John reflected on his experiences. He writes in his journal, "I went to America to convert the Indians, but oh, who shall convert me? Who, what is he that will deliver me from this evil heart of mischief? I have a fair summer religion. I can talk well and believe myself.
while no danger is near, but let death look me in the face, and my spirit is troubled, nor can I say, to die is gain.
So John realized that something wasn't quite right in his heart and his faith. And while John was wrestling with his faith, he met a group that seemed to be confident and assured in their faith, even in the midst of a raging storm. It sounds like they're in the middle of this hurricane, and the Moravians are singing their hymns, perfectly at peace. And their faith in the midst of this raging storm left an impression on John. And later, through those connections, he meets Peter Boland, who invited him to come and join a part of the group, to join their fellowship. And so he continued to lean into that stirring of his heart. Peter told him, preach faith till you have it. And then because you have it, you will preach faith. Sort of like fake it till you make it almost, right? Don't give up now. Work through this hard moment. Keep pressing on. And it wouldn't be long before John would find that faith that he was looking for. On May 24th, he writes in his journal, saying, in the evening I went rather unwillingly to a society in Aldersgate Street, where one was reading Luther's preface, the Epistle of Romans. All right, he's reading the introduction to a commentary. And about a quarter before nine, while he was describing the change which God works in the heart through faith, I felt my heart strangely warmed. I felt that I did trust in Christ, Christ alone, for salvation. And an assurance was given me that he had taken away my sins, even mine, and saved me from the law of sin and death. And that night, fire was lit. From that moment on, John Mark Wesley's heart was on fire. A fire that would not only change him, but a fire that would change the world. For a heart that is set on fire doesn't just change us, but can change the world. What set John apart wasn't his personal piety, but his call to reach out to the least, the lost, the left out, those who are left on the margins of society. John paid close attention to personal and social holiness, trying to build a life worthy of the foundation that had been laid. And he challenged the established religious systems of his day. While he was methodical in his ways of discipleship, John was particularly drawn to preaching the grace that he had received, challenging the ways of the existing church, to the point where before long, no one would allow him to come into their church and preach in the pulpits. John was calling for a revival. He was calling for a change, a transformational encounter with the grace of God. And while he may not have found his place in the pulpit of England's finest churches or in the mission field in America, John found his mission bringing the gospel to the common people, preaching in the streets, in the open fields, and going even to the places that were dangerous, like the mines, and bringing the gospel to those that were not allowed to participate in the religious community. As John continued to preach and establish groups, that heart was set on fire, would soon set the world on fire. As that movement grew and grew, it crossed over the ocean and came back here to the colonies. And then, as you might know your history, something happened. A war broke out. And with the war, the birth of the church. Now, as you imagine, being a priest in the Church of England probably wasn't the title you wanted when the colonies were at war with England, right? That association, or the Anglican Church, as we call it now. And so those priests encountered some difficulties with the Revolutionary War. Many came, many hopped on the boat, they went back overseas, or went into hiding. And so this left this rapidly growing church without the leadership it needed. But a revival isn't stopped with war or denominational leadership. The movement continued as common men and women stepped up to lead the church. I'll share a little side story here. When we were starting Elko Market, I encountered somebody who was really excited about a new church coming to Elko Market. And so he invited me to breakfast, and I thought he wanted to learn about the church. But he said, hey, you know what? Here's what we can do. I've got this connection, and I'll reach out, I'll make some phone calls, and we'll hire all new professional musicians to come and lead worship. We'll get professional sound and lighting guys to run the show. In fact, you don't even have to preach. We'll just get this video feed.
leadership when no one else was. Methodists called for the abolition of slavery and stood up for civil rights. Methodists called for their neighbors to fall into a deeper commitment to Christ. And at one time, there were more churches in the United States with a Wesleyan tradition than there were post offices. More churches than post offices. And throughout church history, there have been ebbs and flows, and just like with our own walk of faith. Is it perfect? By no means is it perfect. Although I have not met that perfect church yet myself. Maybe Jesus will bring it back, okay? But until then, we're doing the best we can, right? And throughout history, God has brought revival and reforms and fresh expressions of faith as we've stayed connected to the foundation of Christ. Right? We can't forget that foundation. What was once a burning fire in our hearts eventually fades. We forget that foundation that we build our lives upon. And we start adding other worldly materials that don't quite fit with the foundation that was laid. The materials that probably won't stand withstand the testing fires. Our hearts might even grow cold, but God still stirs hearts today. God still breathes revival. And what stirred John Wesley's heart was grace. One of those key building blocks that he put upon that foundation was his understanding of grace. And growing up a son of a minister, John felt that he must chase after God's love, that somehow he must earn that fact that he was saved when he was 6 years old, that he somehow must repay God for the good that he had experienced. While Wesley understood God's grace intellectually, he had not experienced it in this transformative way for himself. Not in a way that would set his heart on fire. Not in a way that would give him the courage to preach. Even though he faced persecution, and at one point they even hired mobs that would come and break up his gatherings because they were afraid of what he was doing. But John eventually found the grace of God that he was looking for. He finally trusted God for himself. As people who have followed in John's footsteps, Jesus is our foundation. And one of those key building blocks we use to build up our lives, God's church, is Wesley's understanding of grace. It's a grace that's offered to us in several ways. First, as Wesleyans, we believe that God makes the first move, that God offers his what we call prevenient grace for us, right? That is God's grace for us even before we know, even before we can understand just how much God loves us, God says, my grace is sufficient for you. God chooses to bless you. The second understanding of God's grace is God's justifying grace. This is that moment of salvation where we say, you know what, I do believe, I do trust Jesus as my Savior, I do want to have Jesus in my life. And in that moment, God wipes away all our sin, forgiving us and offering us the gift of salvation. God not only makes the first move, but God pays the debt on our behalf. And through his Son, Jesus Christ, God opens up a relationship with us. The third kind of grace that Wesley talked about was God's sanctifying grace. You might say that this is grace for everyday life, right? This is grace that covers our sin. This is the grace that helps us to live our lives more like Christ each and every day. This is the grace we need always, because I don't know about you, but I stumble. And I fall. And I mess up. And I'm not always at my best, but the Holy Spirit is still working inside of me. Because I'm still connected to the foundation of Christ. And God says, I will work in you. God's sanctifying grace is that grace that sets a life apart, that we might grow in our understanding of God's love and grow in the image of Christ. God's grace is still at work, isn't it? And our call to proclaim that grace by bringing the message of the gospel to all people and helping them discover the hope that we have in Christ, that is the very foundation of our lives and of our church, right? Jesus Christ. God's grace is there for you even when you in that moment when you come to understand your salvation and just how much God loves you, and God's grace is there for you as you continue to live your life. Has God's grace stirred your heart? Have you experienced a moment in your life where you felt, as John Wesley said, a heart that has been strangely warm? Maybe we can't quite explain it, but there's that sense that God is doing something here. God is doing something in me. God wants to bring something new out of us. For a heart that has been set on fire changes you, and a heart that is set on fire can change the world. Today we're gonna celebrate the sacrament of God's grace. And as we receive communion today, these gifts of bread and juice become more to us than simply nourishment for our bodies. For as we take this, we are receiving that gift. We are saying, Jesus, you are my foundation. You are a part of my life. You are nourishing my soul. And upon this foundation, I will build my life. On the night in which Christ was betrayed, he gathered together his disciples, and he took the bread, and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you." In the same manner, when the supper was over, he took the cup. He gave thanks to God, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take, drink, this is the blood of my covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink of this cup, do this in remembrance of me." You know, it strikes me when I think about it, nobody was perfect in that room with Jesus that night. Just like we aren't perfect, but Jesus says, "I've done this because I love you. You belong to me." So we share together a mystery of faith, realizing we understand imperfectly, but God will do his perfect work in us. We repeat after him, "Christ has died. Christ has risen.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
Christ will come again."
Let's pray. Oh Lord, we thank you that you indeed, Jesus, are the foundation of our lives. Today we profess our faith in you. We say, "God, come into my life. Jesus, come into my heart. Revive me and set my heart on fire in a way that only you can. That I may build a life worthy of the foundation that you have given me." Lord, as we receive these gifts and gratitudes, may they be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be your grand church here on earth to proclaim your kingdom for all who need encouragement and hope with us today, for all who need your love. Lord, sustain us by the grace that you have given. Sustain us and nourish our souls each and every day as we join together the prayer that you taught us to say, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory." Jesus invites us to come to the table. Receive the gift of his will.
Amen.
you might look back at it.